This idea has two starting points. The one, in public perception, is associated with sacrifice and self-denial. And the other, in public perception, is associated with knowledge and aspiration. The one is a nun, and the other, an educator. They're both connected, though, because the nun started me off on my journey of theater, and the educator made me consider the meanings of success and failure and happiness. But let me first set for you some context here. I grew up in Bangalore in the 1970s. I went to convent school. I lived in the cantonment part of town, which was diverse and multilingual. I had birthday parties. My parents ordered for me cakes from Nilgiri's, which was the local cake shop. Overall, an average Indian urban middle class girl. I was a dreamy child in school. My third standard teacher used to call me Alice, which was short for Alice in Wonderland. I must have been of about average intelligence, but I never made it to the toppers in class. I never got one of those ribbons that was awarded to girls who got four very good reports in a row. I never got any roles in school plays, except once I got to play the voice of the mirror of the evil stepmother of Snow White. I never made it to head girl or captain of any house. I think my teachers largely put me in the bad girl drawer just because I was so talkative or imaginative or playful or wild looking. Even in high school, I inhabited a world made up of my own fantasies. I loved playing with my friends, making plays. I got by in studies, nothing too high, nothing too low. And then one day, the nun happened. I had just won an award for best actor in an inter-school competition. And the nun, her name was Sister Faith. She came up to my classroom and she took me by the hand and led me downstairs to the school auditorium where there was a theater company called Natak rehearsing there. And she handed me over to a young actor and said, "And now you're in good hands." I often wonder what she meant by that when she said, "Now you're in good hands." Did she recognize some kind of glint in my eyes, some passion for theater? Or did she just see a girl, a young girl, who needed a hand up? Anyway, my life changed dramatically from that day on. I was smitten. Overnight, I was smitten by the whole idea of rehearsal, of working with text, with body, with voice, being in the company of actors, iconoclastic, rebellious, questioning. I had found my tribe. And the newness of ideas just stunned me. That we would rehearse for months, Three Sisters by Anton Chekhov, Three Sisters by Anton Chekhov, and then not perform it at the end of it. This was a revolutionary idea for a 14-year-old who up until this point had thought that the only reason to work on anything at all was to perform it for an adoring public and then receive fabulous affirmation. Anyway, this ideal continued for a bit, and then suddenly it was time for all those big questions. Who will I be? What will I do? How will I earn a living? I had been acting in plays for a while now. I was also singing in rock bands. And a musical that I'd been in had traveled the country. Oh, I forgot to tell you. The thing that I learned with Natak was that the journey is the thing, not the product. And this is what was revolutionary and exciting for a 14-year-old. Now, as I said, I'd been traveling for a while with this musical, acting in plays, singing with a rock band. This clicker has me so confused, forgive me. And during this time that I was doing all this exciting stuff, I was also ostensibly studying for a degree in science. But the whole while that I was in the classroom, I was actually dreaming of performing, of singing, of being with my tribe. While my classmates went on botany field trips, I just bunked and hung out at music festivals. This whole idea of performance and creativity had me bewitched. Now, it was about this time that a well-meaning uncle, would you please put up your hands if you have a well-meaning uncle? All right. So a well-meaning uncle said to my father that nobody would marry me because I was a cabaret artist. Now, just look at the choice of words. Marriage versus cabaret artist. Two drawers, and the words were chosen fully intended to put me into one slot or the other. My parents, to their great credit, completely ignored the cabaret artist jibe. But the fundamental point being made here was that for a woman performer, somebody who chose to put themselves in the public gaze, and that to put yourself in the public gaze and earn a living from it, you basically dangled precariously on the lowest rungs of the morality ladder. Marriage, the idea was floated, is something that happens somewhat based on a man's income, but definitely based on a woman's virtue. And by that yardstick, an actor, a woman performer, and that too myself, who is an English-speaking Indian artist, not an Indian classical singer or dancer, not even a folk performer, not even an actor performing in the local language, but someone performing in the English language, really has zero locus standi. So let's see about where we are right now. Child, bad girl, teenager, cabaret artist, young adult, English-speaking Indian artist, and what was to come in the years ahead would be how on earth one earns a living. Now, just about this time, or let's fast forward a few years from now, I've been acting now for about 30-odd years, and one day, one of my young theater students, a really creative young woman, she'd been having all these doubts about who am I going to be, what will I do to earn a living, etc. She called me up and she said that a well-meaning family friend had said to her, look, enough with the shilly-shallying and following your dreams nonsense. You just better step on it. Do you want your life to be like Kirtana's? I bet you didn't see that coming. I certainly didn't see that coming. I hadn't realized that up until this point, I'd never realized that in public perception, my life was crap. So I did what actors are supposed to do. I reckoned with the whole situation and I observed my world. Bangalore is a fairly expensive, affluent city, the IT capital of the country. But more and more I found my young students coming to me and speaking of enhanced levels of depression, of anxiety and stress caused by notions of success and achievement. Body image had become a really, really big thing. They also told me that social media was snowballing the impact that public perception had on their self-worth. Many of my teenage students know other teenagers who either self-harm or have taken their own lives. Very recently, as all of you are very well aware, the epitome of success, one of Bangalore's very well-loved businessmen committed suicide. I looked at all of this and I thought, now, what joins the dots? What is the link between all of this? It has to do with our notions of success. But the truth is that theater in India really doesn't have any support at all. We have no social security, there is no acclaim, no affirmation. So then I thought, let me take stock. What is this life that I hold up before my young students? How dare I teach them to love theater or love the act of creating something when they live in a world that young people feel harnessed by a market-driven framework of success or expectations? What is this thing that I'm teaching them when they live in this sort of world? That's when I had. And then I also asked myself, maybe that educator is right. Maybe, in fact, your life should not be like Kirtana's. But then I still had this niggling doubt. And that's when I had my epiphany. Everyone cannot have my life. You have to have some, it's a charmed life. So you have to have some certain qualities in order to earn this life. And what are these qualities? The first is love. You have to really, really love doing theater and love all aspects of it, not just performance, because that will dry up soon enough. You have to love chasing something that is elusive and non-material. The second is imagination. You jolly well have to have the imagination to look at all the obstacles and drawbacks that society perceives for you, look at them and understand that they are, in fact, your superpowers. They are your strengths. And finally, the pursuit of freedom, not the pursuit of security or safety, but the thrilling, heart-stopping pursuit of autonomy and freedom. So then I thought, all right, the first and the third, it's up to you. It differs from person to person. It differs, and it depends on circumstance, situation, privilege, many different things. But the middle one, imagination, is pertinent to all of us. And it's exactly where most of us stumble. And it's exactly the thing that stands in the way of our having or redefining ideas of success. So let us look for now at my own obstacles. Number one, English-speaking Indian artist. The reason I am an English-speaking Indian artist is because I come from three generations of very brave people who broke the shackles of caste, community, and language. This is brilliant. This is a disruption. This makes me pan-Indian. Ribbon number one. The second, outsider. Being an outsider really gives me a vantage point as an artist because I can provoke, I can challenge, I can question. I don't have to be limited by the barriers of convention or tradition or rank habit. And talking about tradition, which gives me my third ribbon, whatever I had to fight in the form of tradition or convention, it made me work really hard to call myself an artist. Very early, I decided that if I dared call myself an artist, a theater artist, I was going to have to earn a living from it. Ribbon number three. And that brings me to the final one, which is how I was going to earn my living. I really spread my wings and said, okay, so this is real, this is happening. I'm going to make for myself a theater industry. I didn't think theater industry. I thought I'm going to earn a living. And slowly I found I was making for myself a theater industry. Now, talking about this theater industry, I learned to get work for myself as an actor, but I also learned that I should get paid for my work as an actor. In those days, this really ruffled feathers. Asking to be paid to get work as an actor, it ruffled feathers. People thought that middle-class Indians only ever did theater as a hobby, but the word hobby was anathema to me. I was not going to do theater as a hobby. Theater was going to be my life. And so then, I decided in 1994 to start developing my own urban contemporary Indian works and start directing them. I then began working with theatre in the social sector. I did theatre with sex workers in Andhra, with intravenous drug users in Manipur. I worked with theatre and truckers in a place called Sanjay Gandhi Transport Nagar in Delhi. I worked with Kotis in Belgaum. And in this way, I was travelling all over the country. I extended my theater practice into documentary filmmaking, and the questions I had about sexuality or freedom or justice or technology, I extended to real people, and I received answers there. When my daughter was very young, I started a little theater lab for her and her friends. She very soon grew out of it and became a guitarist, but theater lab continued growing, and now it's about 25 years old, and I have 50 students. My love of text also got me paying work as a dramaturg. And because I was asking all these different questions, questions across culture, from urban to rural, or modern to traditional, or digital to analog, asking questions about why people respond so differently in different cultures and in different situations, but remain fundamentally the same with their dreams, I found myself on yet another journey. That of theatre in interculturality. And this brings me back to the beginning. This is my 360-degree moment. Two people, two cultures, two very different perspectives. The nun and the educator. The nun witnessed a child who liked to play and saw possibility. The educator witnessed a child who liked to play and saw failure. The one gave me wings, the other made me recognize the outdated parameters of success that are enforced on young people. The one made me get past narrow parameters that visualize success as a sliding scale from local to national to international. The one made me really think about different values, values of commitment, of community, and of contentment, and not of being someone. She taught me instead to delve into joyousness and fulfillment. So this thing called play, we do a play. It's called that because it allows us to literally play with each other like children in a community. We can make mistakes, we can fail gloriously, we can be idiots. And it's all okay. It's more than okay. It's part of our job definition. It's part of the creative process. And playing is much more than just playing, because it frees the mind and it allows you blissfulness. Playing is also free, accessible to everybody. It's sort of an equal opportunity lover. But the other side of playing, its bitch sister, if you like, is craftsmanship. And craftsmanship is a lifelong journey in learning, commitment, and practice. It's not always easy, and nobody may know or hear about it. It's a journey in invisibility. It's only you who practice, you read, you write, you learn, you create, you perform, and you figure ways to earn a living. But it's a journey worth making, because it returns you 360 degrees to you, to what you want, to what you know, and to how you will go forward. Today I know, okay, so I'm somewhat an actor, I suppose you could say, but I could also be a director. I could be a dramaturg or a pedagogue. I could write a critique. I could design a set. I could, at a pinch, do lights and makeup. And when you do this, you realize you have to keep inventing and reinventing and creating constantly new ideas for plays, for workshops, for articles. And when you do this, you meet with the ideas of other people. And that's when you realize something truly incredible, that the road less taken is a blessed thing. For travelers of the heart really hold infinity in the palm of their hand. Thank you.